So now we are discussing on the ARM microcontroller, the technical details. So now we know it uses ARM architecture. That is the first thing. And the second thing, okay, so you see here, you have, you know, byte is 8 bit. Okay, the word length of the register present in ARM microprocessor is 32 bit. Whereas in 8051, the word length was 8 bit. So that means you can store only 8 bit of data in each register. Whereas in ARM, you can store 32 bit data in one register. Okay, so that is the word length. Okay, in ARM. So similarly, off length means 16 bit. Separately, you can use 16 bit register in ARM like 8086. So what we discussed in 8086, you can split that 16 bit register into two 8 bit register. Similarly, here also you can separately use the 32 bit register as a 4, 8 bit register. Okay, so that option you have. Now here is the one important thing. So ARM instruction set. I already told, if you have a 32 bit instruction set, okay, so it is called ARM instruction set. So ARM instruction set. So always, if your microprocessor or microcontroller is 32 bit and your register size is 32 bit and your instruction is also 32 bit in length. Okay, so your instruction also 32 bit length. So that is called ARM instruction set. Okay, ARM instruction set. Now what? Then what they did in ARM, microcontroller and microprocessor, they introduced some thing called thumb instruction set. Okay, this word is important. So this question may come in any interview or in any aptitude test. Okay, thumb instruction set. Thumb instruction set, they simplified. Okay. So the 32 bit instruction was, bigger and it was taking a lot of time. Then they created one more instruction set, okay, the simplified instruction set, that is 16-bit instruction set. So that they called it as thumb instruction set. How it works? Say for example, if you have a 32-bit instruction, okay, so now they broken that particular instruction into two instruction. Okay, so where that happens? That happens in the compilation stage. Okay, that happens in the compilation stage. Now you are writing a program in C program. Okay, so you have an option to compile to 32 bit ARM instruction set, or you can also go for 16 bit thumb instruction set. So in the compilation process itself, that will be optimized. Okay, and it will generate the corresponding the program. So in that you can map your program to 16-bit thumb instruction set, or you can map to 32-bit instruction set. That option you have. So now in case of 32-bit instruction set, thumb instruction set, what happens? The time required is less. Okay, time required is less. Now the idea is very simple. Now when you map to 32-bit instruction set and if you compile your program, then what happens, say for example, two instructions are there. One instruction takes, 1 microsecond. So if you have 4 instruction set, then it will take 4 microsecond. Okay, so that is what happens in 32-bit ARM, instruction set. Now what they did, they introduced this thumb instruction set. Now say for example, you have a 4 instructions, in ARM. So using this particular 4 instruction, can I optimize and using this particular thumb instruction set, and can I convert that to 3 instruction set? Now, then what happens? It will take only 3 microsecond time. So in that way, what happens? The thumb instruction set, proven to be faster compared to the 32-bit ARM instruction set. Okay. So thumb instruction set is also one very good feature in the ARM. Okay. Thumb instruction set. Okay, and then this is very important. Okay, see, JSLA, okay, is basically environment. Okay, so it's like a runtime environment provided in the hardware itself. Okay, provided in the hardware itself. What is this JSLA does? So you can execute the Java bytecodes. Okay, now what happens when you write a Java program? Okay, so when you write a Java program, so what you will be doing, you will be converting that particular Java code to bytecode first, then you will be converting to binaries. You understood, no? So that is what normally you do. So when you convert to bytecode, when you convert your Java program to bytecode, that bytecode you can directly run in the ARM microprocessor itself. So that is basically that platform is called JSLA. So that you won't find in any conventional microprocessor or microcontroller. You have to load binary program to the memory and you have to run. So that was the concept. Now here what they did, they provided a hardware. Okay. So that can be used as a runtime environment for the Java program. You see, that means you can directly run your Java program in the ARM microprocessor. Okay, so that is one advantage in this particular that is one feature in ARM microprocessor. Okay, now whenever it comes to the ARM, okay, so this is very important. Okay, this is very important. Now you see, I already told it is basically the security. Okay, security. If you use 8051, okay, now what I can do, if I open the particular application, I can clearly see which sensor is connected to which port. Okay, and you know that you cannot do any encryptions in 8051. Okay, so direct sensor data will come and it will goes to the the port, and it goes inside the memory, and it uses the program uses. Now if I see that particular thing, I can easily tap that particular pin and I can see that information, okay, in some other place. You see, so that is there is no protection provided for that particular application, not the protection. And also, see, for example, if you are executing some task, okay, and altogether you cannot shift to the other task. Okay, what does it mean? Say for example, you are running some, say for example, I made one application. That application is to measure the energy, and other application is to find out whether fault happened or not. See, these two applications are there. These two programs, I will put it in the microprocessor and microcontroller. One is energy measurement, other one is fault detection. Now, so when the energy measurement is happening, I cannot run the fault detection. Whenever I am running fault detection, I cannot run the energy measurement. So these things are independent. So you cannot run any independent tasks in the conventional microprocessor and microcontroller. Okay, so conventional microprocessor microcontroller you cannot run. So you can create a function and you can go to that particular function and you can call, but sequentially that will work. But the problem is the state of that particular task is not reserved anywhere in conventional microprocessor and microcontroller. What is that? The state of that particular task is not saved anywhere in the microcontroller or microprocessor. Say now I am just making energy measurement, I'll go to the fault, and then all this energy measurement content will be erased. Okay, that will become some kind of junk. Okay, you are making the fault detection, so that particular functionality will run in ARM. Then all those status will be there. In state means maybe status word register, it may be the stack pointer, it may be the program counter. Okay, so it may be the memory values. So all these things are considered as a state. Okay, so basically that defines how that program is running, what it is running, what it is doing. So all these things will be conveyed by that particular values. So that means whenever you have a two task, it won't preserve the state. Okay, state of that particular operations, different two independent operation. So that is completely implemented in this particular ARM processor. So now the thing is, you can have two independent tasks. One more thing, for the understanding purpose, I'll tell you. Say for example, you have a computer. Okay, I mean it is a direct connection. This is the direct connection with this particular ARM. So you have a computer. So you can create different user in your computer, correct? You can create many users in your computer. Okay, and you can have an administrator. So administrator user, and also many users you can have. And you, what you can do, you can give some privileges to different users. Say, for example, in our lab, we cannot access the USB port, correct? So that privilege is not there. Okay, administrator is blocked that particular privileges. That means one user will have some privileges, other users will have some other privileges. Now the thing is what? Two different user, okay, two different state, two different state. Now what is the advantage of this particular task? See, now you can log in to different users at the same time. Now you see, you can log in, start some process, log out, and then you can immediately log in to other user. When you are logging to that particular user, you can also log in to some other user. You see, so simultaneously you can have two users logged in to the same machine. So that is possible. Now when this happens, you can see clearly that when two persons are logged in to one hardware, so that means both the people are doing the same task, different task, okay, independent task, then that particular hardware is handling, okay, so that particular hardware is handling that particular thing. Then how that is taken care. So it is basically this, okay. So you have different modes, okay, in the ARM microprocessor, okay, different modes in the ARM microprocessor. Okay, so what is that different mode? So you have a user mode, fast interrupt mode, okay, interrupt mode, supervisor mode, abort mode, undefined mode, okay, system mode. Okay, many other modes are also there. So now what is this mode? Okay, different modes. So this means each mode has its own registers. Okay, so now I'll just show you the picture. Can you see here? See, now assume that this is the physically you have, say for example, earlier, if you see the 8051 microcontroller, only one program counter is there. Okay, only one program counter is there. Okay, so in this particular case, you have, six, seven, how many modes? You have, three, six, seven. Okay, seven modes are here. So seven program counters will be there. You understood? Seven program counters. So that means when you go from one state to other state, here the program counter will be preserved as it is. And when you move to the next mode, then there also you will have one physical program counter. You understood? So you don't have one program counter. Instead, you have many, stack pointer or link register, you have many. So in that particular state, the register bank is also different. Okay, so you have that particular mode has its own register bank. Okay, so now see here, in this particular mode you have R0 to R15. These are the 16 general purpose registers, special function register what you have in ARM microprocessor. Normally, I already told you, you have to see the memory model. Okay, programming model you have to see whenever you study any microcontroller and microprocessor. There you have A register, B register, R0 register, R1 register, like that. But here you don't have A register, B register. Instead, you have R0 to R15 register. Okay, and you have current program status word. There you had something like PSW, program status word, in 8051. Here they are calling it as current program status register, CPSR, current program status register. That is same as program status word in 8051. Okay, so similarly here the special function register, okay, is basically R0 to R15. Okay, so in that R13 is always called as stack pointer, R14 is always called as link register, and R15 is called as program counter. Program counter is basically holds the address of the current executing instruction. Okay, stack pointer always keeps the address. Okay, address of the instruction whenever that particular address will be copied to the program counter whenever return instruction comes. Okay, and link register will basically load the address to the stack pointer. Okay, so whenever it moves from one mode to the other mode. So that is the definition of this register. But R0 to R12, what you can see, it is a general purpose register, like accumulator. So you can use for different operations like addition, subtraction, you know, or many instructions will be associated with this register. Okay, say move A comma B. So you can use move R0 comma R1 like that. So you can use that register to write a program. Okay, so then you see here, you have one more register called saved program status register. Saved program status register. Now say, for example, here I am in user mode. I want to shift from user mode to interrupt mode. Interrupt mode means something, something happened, or I want to move to, some kind of interrupt programming. Okay, so in that case, what happens? Different mode. Okay, so just I need to preserve this particular state. Then what happens? What is common in there? So R8 to R14. Okay, whatever register content is available in that particular register, okay, will be taken now. You see, the user mode register content, whatever was there, everything will be saved. It will be there as it is. Only what happens, the orange color registers will become your mainstream now. Whatever the R0 to R50, R14 content was there, that will be there in the register as it is. Okay, so that will be there in the register as it is. Now you can see, so R0 to R15 came to mainstream. Okay, so that now I am calling this as fast interrupt mode. And your earlier you had one program counter. That program counter will be copied to SPSR. SPSR means saved program status register. Okay, saved program status register. Okay, so now normally what happens, the saved program status register content will be copied to program status word. Okay, so that means that particular mode is selected. You understood? So that means whenever you copy from saved program status word to current program status register, that means you are changing the mode. Okay, you are changing the mode. That corresponding register will be considered. Okay, so now this is how the shifting of the mode happens. Shifting of mode happens. So now, you can see here now user mode. Okay, I went to interrupt mode, and the state. The state of the user mode is preserved. Okay, and whenever I want to jump to user mode, I just copy the status saved program status word to current status word. Then immediately it will come to user mode. You understood? So in this way, inside ARM, the mode will be mode will change from one mode to other mode. That means one user to other user. Like that, you have 7-8 users, so it will shift from one user to other user. Okay, so I'll just see. Okay, so any questions, please do ask. This is very important. So unlike the conventional microprocessor, is you don't have different modes, but in ARM only they have introduced this kind of concept. Any questions? Any questions related to this ARM? So any questions on ARM? How this mode will shift from one mode to other mode? You understood? So, and also get familiar with the terminologies here. Okay. So we are just discussing on the ARM. And what we understood, there are different modes are there. Okay, there are different modes are there in ARM. Okay, so that is what we understood. Some keywords, RISC architecture we understood. Okay, and also we understood some features are there. It's a 32-bit microprocessor. And also we understood something on thumb instruction set. Okay. And we understood the different modes, And we understood that, you know, we can preserve the state of the users or state of the different modes in microprocessor hardware level. You understood. So that is also one point what we understood. So if you have any questions, please do ask. Because, you know, if you don't understand this particular concept in, you know, later stages, you cannot understand. Okay, so that's why just make sure that you know all these things. So in this case, what happens? You know, say for example, why these different modes are there? Assume that I am using my laptop. Okay, suddenly temperature is increased in my microprocessor. Okay, now what is the consequence? So I am just logged in as some user. I am just working something. Okay, that means if I am working on some application, that means I am working on a hardware. Correct. So then I am just working on a hardware. Now I am in user mode. You understood? I am in user mode. Suddenly the temperature is increased in the microprocessor motherboard. Then immediately immediately temperature will increase. So that microprocessor, the information, okay, fan speed or temperature values, this particular user do not have access. Okay. This particular user do not have any access. Then immediately what should happen? So immediately that user mode should shift to interrupt mode. Okay, interrupt mode or super user. Then it has to go to interrupt mode. Then in interrupt mode, those parameters are accessible. Okay, so those parameters are accessible. Then what happens? That particular function, when temperature increases, what should happen? So that function should execute. So whenever it shift to the user mode, and then corresponding interrupt subroutine will be executed. Okay, then what happens? Maybe temperature increases, maybe some notification should come to you that temperature is increased. You just have to shut down the system, or if the temperature is too much, then it will automatically switch off the system. So these things, where happens? It happens in different mode. Okay, so unlike in the conventional microprocessor and microcontroller, so it is just not shifting to some functions available in the code memory. Okay, so here it has to shift to different mode, and then it has to shift to different function. So that is one change concept introduced in this particular ARM. Okay, so ARM has different modes. Okay, different modes have different privileges. Okay, so if you want to perform some task, you cannot execute all the task in all the modes. Okay, some specific tasks are defined in some modes. Okay, so if you want to execute that task, you have to go to that mode. Okay, so that is what you have to understand. Okay, any questions? And terminologies, just remember this, R0 to R15. Now, whenever we are writing program, okay, in ARM, so we cannot use MOV A,10. You understood? Okay, we cannot use, because that register is not there. A register is not there. Okay, whenever we are writing C program, okay, so that corresponding editor file, we have to import. And then R0 is equal to 10. Okay, so like that, we have to define. So don't use the register which is not present in ARM. Now from this point onwards, just remember R0 to R15. This kind of register will come in microprocessor and microcontroller. Okay. So and also CPSR, current program status register, SPSR, saved program status register, PC, program counter, SP, stack pointer, LR, link register. Link register, program counter, stack pointer, or address. You understood? Address. Okay, so how that changes, we already know. Program counter, it increases. Okay, it holds the address of the instruction which is executing currently. That never changes in any microcontroller or microprocessor. Okay, so current program status word. So that state always you see jump on borrow, jump on no carry, all this instruction we use. Na? Any additional arithmetic operations, any operations we do in microcontroller. So ALU is connected to program status word. ALU is directly connected to program status word. Here, program status register is directly connected to program status register. Whatever operation you are doing, okay. So that operation, the information of that particular operation is present in program status register. So that is current program status word register. So that's why this register is very important in microprocessor. This has some setting detail, okay, settings. Or no configuration, okay, for every operation, some return value along with result, some operation details will be present in this particular program status register. So that's why you just have to remember this particular register. Okay, am I clear on this particular concept? See, user mode, I just came to fast interrupt mode. Then I went to user mode. Then I came to, interrupt mode, just interrupt mode. What register it copies, it's different. Okay. Then supervisor mode. Then again user mode. Then undefined mode. Then again user mode. Then abort mode. And then user mode. Like that. Okay, so this is the complete the register banks what you have, okay, in 8051 ARM microprocessor. Any questions on this? So I just want to pause here. I'll continue in the next class, but if you have any questions, please do ask. Questions, please. I just have to keep some marks for CA3. If you have some questions, then some marks. So you have to ask questions. Yeah. So any questions? You can get any material from the internet, that is not a problem. The only one thing what you have to understand from these classes, some terminologies, it goes to your mind. Okay. And, ARM, when you take up this particular ARM to study, it is a bit complex. So, initially we just have to discuss on this ARM and then get some confidence that just get some, that overview. Otherwise, you have to spend a lot of time in this particular ARM. It takes a lot of time, to understand the, the difference between conventional microprocessor and microcontroller. And even when you go to advanced level, using this microcontroller and putting in the application, and completely, if you don't understand these things, you cannot do that kind of, embedded programming. Now I told you never use conventional microprocessor or microcontroller. Try to use ARM for any product whatever you build. Okay, whatever product you are trying to build, try to use ARM. Okay, and build your application. So then definitely that is kind of people will appreciate, and definitely it works. Okay, don't use conventional, so that may be easy, but that is not the advanced one. Okay, so then you just have to practice this particular ARM. Okay, you should try to understand this particular ARM microprocessor. Fine. Yeah. Any questions? Any questions? So any questions? Shall we close now? Shall we close? Okay. So tomorrow we'll continue, and we will discuss on what are the registers you have, okay, in ARM, and how can you write a program, and what are the different variants are there in ARM. So all those things we'll understand. Okay. Yeah, I'll just take the attendance.